The Antiquities Act withdrawals, particularly as we anticipate they will be modified by Congress, pose no real threat to Alaska's economy. What we're doing is giving future generations a chance to see Alaska unspoiled and undeveloped as it was in the past.
What do you think of the Antiquities Act?
I think that they've taken a law that was not designed to do what they've used it as. I feel, for one, that it's an illegal law, the way it's been used, and that it's morally wrong for the people of this state to abide by it.
In what surely must be the most confusing and complicated issue to cloud the minds of many Alaskans, laws governing the land in Alaska have had little understanding among the masses. People simply have problems figuring out what is going on. Decrees are sent from Washington. Neighbors are marching in the street. The president gets burned in effigy. Why are these people so agitated? It all started over a century ago. In 1867, the federal government bought Alaska from Russia. At that point, all the land in the new territory was owned by the federal government. 92 years later, in 1959, the territory became the state of Alaska. The Statehood Act, passed by Congress, gave Alaska ownership of 103 million acres, or about one-third of the available land. The rest of the land would remain property of the federal government. The state was given 25 years to decide what land it wanted. But the Alaskan natives had yet to claim land they felt was theirs. The government recognized their right, and in 1966, Stuart Udall, the Secretary of the Interior under Lyndon Johnson, stopped the state from selecting its lands until the question of the native land claims could be settled. It looked like a slow process, but the discovery of oil at Prudhoe Bay 2 years later brought political pressure to quickly settle the native land claims so the pipeline could be built. So in 1971, Congress responded and passed the Alaska Native Claims Settlement Act. This gave the natives 44 million acres and nearly $1 billion. However, state selection of land did not continue. Section 17D of the Alaska Native Claims Settlement Act said that to protect the federal interest, land had to be classified. Furthermore, Section 17D2 gave the Secretary of the Interior the authority to withdraw 83 million acres to add to what is known as the four national conservation systems: wild and scenic rivers, national forests, national parks, and wildlife refuges. The environmentalists were delighted. Congress felt the job could be done relatively quickly and set a deadline of December 18, 1978 for the D2 lands to be selected. In the House of Representatives, this man, Morris Udall, the congressman from Arizona, took up the cause of the environmentalists to preserve the land. He also felt the 103 million acres provided in the Statehood Act was plenty for Alaskan development.
Well, Alaska's so big, you can have your cake and eat it too if you do it right. When we get all through, if my bill goes through exactly the way it is, and it won't, we're going to cut it down a little bit, but if it were to go through exactly the way it is, you'd have an area left over the size of Texas for mining, for homes, for oil development, for minerals, for all of these other things. Alaska's been very fortunate. We got 9 million acres in my great state of Arizona for a land base, the rest in the hands of the federal government. Up here it isn't 9 or 99, it's 103 million acres. It's 10 to 1 more than we got down there. So there'll be a plenty big land base for Alaska left.
His legislation, known as H.R. 39, overwhelmingly passed the House in May of 78 by a vote of 277 to 31. By November of that year, the Secretary of the Interior, Cecil Andrus, withdrew 121 million acres by authority given to him by the Federal Land Policy and Management Act. By using this law, the Secretary was in essence saying he felt the national interest lands were in danger of being altered and seriously affected from their natural state. On the Senate side of Capitol Hill, the Alaska land legislation became clogged in a bottleneck. Intense effort was made to reach a compromise, but Senator Mike Revelle threatened to filibuster on the Senate floor if a bill was introduced that he felt was not in Alaska's best interest. He was later severely criticized by some and lavishly praised by others for such a bold move. Consequently, time was running out on the self-imposed congressional deadline of December 18, 1978. It soon became evident that no legislation would be passed by Congress before it adjourned. Up until now, only the Congress was active in the Alaska lands issue. But once it became clear that no bill would be passed, President Carter stepped in. Out of all the alternatives available to him, Carter invoked the Antiquities Act on December 1, 1978. This set aside 56 million acres in 17 newly created national monuments. We asked Senator Ted Stevens if the proclamation was necessary.
No, it was not. I asked the president, urged the president not to do that. There was adequate protection for Alaska's lands under the D2 withdrawals. There was no chance for imminent development during the winter period. And I believe that we had convinced the president, I thought we'd convinced the president and Secretary Andrus that we would act quickly, relatively quickly, on a D2 bill this year. By having acted, he has complicated the consideration of the D2 legislation, not accelerated.
The Interior Department urged President Carter to create the new monuments as an extra layer of protection for the national interest lands. But Special Counsel to the Governor, John Katz, told Alaska Review the Interior Department's fears were unfounded.
We did not see the immediate damage that the possibility of immediate damage that they talked about. And as a legal matter, we felt that there was sufficient protection without the use of the Antiquities Act. In fact, the environmental supplement itself indicated that the various layers of public land withdrawals provided adequate protection.
According to the Antiquities Act of 1906, the President of the United States is authorized, in his discretion, to declare by public proclamation historic landmarks, historic and prehistoric structures, and other objects of historic or scientific interest to be national monuments. 22 states have national monuments within their boundaries. Here in Alaska, the Antiquities Act has already been used 3 times. President Taft created Sitka National Monument in 1910, President Wilson proclaimed Katmai National Monument in 1918, and President Coolidge created Glacier Bay National Monument in 1925. But those monuments represent a mere sliver when compared to what President Carter has done. The 17 new monuments represent the largest area of land ever set aside by presidential proclamation in the history of the United States. These 56 million acres will be managed by 3 agencies, the National Park Service, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and the Forest Service. Many of the protected areas include geographic and archaeological artifacts that the government feels should be protected and studied. Bob Belous from the National Park Service.
We have within, well, more than one, but one especially, a site that traces human occupation back in Arctic environs for 10,500 years. The place is called Onion Portage. It is one of world renown. We have a second one also that is, I think, on equal status, and it's called Cape Krusenstern. So there are historic resources that show, for example, the history of Eskimo people back in unbroken continuity for 4,000 and 5,000 years. These are special. These are unique. And unique things of national significance are what make up the national park system.
Prior to December 1st, the Park Service managed about 10 million acres and 82 national monuments. By adding the 13 Alaskan monuments, the Park Service now manages nearly 50 million acres. The new monuments the Park Service manages in Alaska is larger than the state of Iowa. Was the intent of Congress to create a law that would give the president such broad power over so much land? The congressional record reveals this conversation, which took place in 1906 between Representative John Steffens from Texas and Representative John Lacey from Iowa. They are discussing the Antiquities Act.
How much land will be taken off the market in the western states by the passage of the bill?
Not very much. The bill provides that it shall be the smallest area necessary for the care and maintenance of the objects to be preserved.
Would it be anything like the Forest Reserve Bill, by which 70 or 80 million acres of land in the United States have been tied up?
Certainly not. The object is entirely different. It's to preserve these old objects of special interest and the Indian remains in the pueblos in the southwest, while the other reserves the forest and the watercourses.
I hope this bill does not result in locking up other lands.
Furthermore, the Act states, The limits in all cases shall be confined to the smallest area compatible with the proper care and management of the objects to be protected. When land is reclassified, the laws that govern the land are usually changed. In most of the new national monuments, three major interim rules have been set, with final rules to be made after public hearings. Subsistence hunting will continue, the land will be closed to new mining, and sports hunting will not be allowed.
Proclamations under the Antiquities Act do not include sport hunting unless specifically stated, and such is not specifically stated. The only special provision is given to subsistence use. But sport hunting, the introduction of sport hunting in national monuments under the Antiquities Act through changes in the regulations is not available.
Many Alaskans are upset with these regulations, especially sport hunters.
How many know about Great Denali Trespass? Yeah.
After staging smaller protests in Fairbanks and Anchorage, a coalition of various organizations rallied together for a mass demonstration against the Antiquities Act. Billed as the Great Denali Trespass, 1,500 people gathered in the new Denali Monument near Cantwell to let off steam and show their anger against what they call a land lockup. To emphasize what they feel is excessive restrictions, the protesters peacefully broke many of the new regulations that govern the monument. While the event itself was designed as a family outing, the reasons behind it are serious. This particular group of Alaskans wants the federal government to know it has overstepped itself in Alaska. But the sport hunters are not alone. The state government is gearing up for a two-pronged attack: lobby for a good lands bill in Washington and fight the existing laws in court. Governor Jay Hammond submitted this outline in his State of the State address.
First, I'm calling on this legislature to pass as a first order of business a $2.5 million appropriation to be used in this endeavor. Some of that money will be used to focus Alaskan energies and efforts here at home. Some will be used to solicit strong support from other states on behalf of those positions which should be of concern to them. We'll also use some of this money to lobby productively in Washington. As well, I will apply all our legal resources to press our lawsuit against the president.
The lawsuit is challenging much of the existing federal regulation, but is zeroing in on the Antiquities Act.
And our basic argument in the lawsuit is that the Antiquities Act has never before been used on the massive scale to which the president used it in Alaska, and we're questioning the president's authority to use it in that manner.
Joining the state in their lawsuit against the president is Citizens for the Management of Alaska Lands, a lobbying group who represents Alaskan business interests.
We're contesting in court the way in which he did it. We believe he violated the act itself. We believe he has violated the Statehood Act. We believe he's violated that traditional separation of powers between the Congress and the president, in that Congress has reserved unto itself the right to classify land, not the president. And in effect, what the President of the United States has done is classify federal lands after the Congress failed or refused to do it. So our argument is that the President has usurped the power of Congress.
The governor has called for a unified Alaskan front to try to get the best bill passed through Congress. The future of the state may very well depend on how successful the lobbying effort can achieve these 6 points that Hammond sees as essential to a good bill: congressional revocation of the Antiquities Act, conveyance of full statehood and native land entitlements, adequate access across federal land to state and private land, state management of fish and game on all lands in Alaska, land classification that will not destroy potential for utilizing known valuable resources, maximum potential retention for traditional Alaskan land usage. But the state cannot make any decisions by itself. It must come from Washington, D.C.
It was important that the decision about Alaska lands be made, and it's going to be made, but it was important that it not be made by one man sitting in the Oval Office. This is a matter not for some people in Juneau, and not for some people in Fairbanks, or not for some people in Denver, or one man in Washington. This is a decision for the American people to make. These are their lands, and it was up to the Congress to make the final decision.
The lands issue has been burning since statehood, but maybe this time Congress will put out the fire by passing legislation that will be acceptable to the many factions who have diversified interests in Alaska lands.
My hope is that this Congress will resolve this issue. We must get it resolved in order to avoid the real trouble that will come out of the Antiquities Act withdrawals, which will be a burden to many Alaskans individually who live in the areas and use those lands. And I also think that it's necessary to get the bill passed so we can get our title to state and native lands. So it's my hope that the Congress will pass the bill sometime in the first 9 months of this year.
We can't violate a law that's illegal, can we? That's right. They're done with the Antiquities Act and up with our own rights. We need that.
The Antiquities Act has raised the ire of many Alaskans, and the people that are most upset are Alaskans who utilize the land. Miners, trappers, sportsmen, and professional guides like Clark Engle stand to lose a lot. Engle has an assigned guide area that has been swallowed up by the McKinley Park South Addition.
At 10:36 in the morning, the peanut farmer signed my life away. He signed the Antiquities Act into existence for Alaska, taking 56 million acres away from the control of the state. And put me essentially out of business. He doesn't take all of my hunting country. What he's done is he's taken the best and left me the dredgings. And this has happened all over the state. It's not just myself. It's happened all over the state. If the people will take their maps out and look at the areas, you'll find that these are the finest game areas in the state of Alaska that were signed into the Antiquities Act. But not only the game animals, the finest mining area.
But Alaskans like Engle aren't giving up without a fight. He has spearheaded the formation of Alaskans United, an organization that purposefully broke the law and is working to get the Antiquities Act repealed.
And I think that's what it's all about up here. I don't really believe that the people will allow a compromise position. I believe that the politicians, whether they be in administration under Hammond or back in Washington, D.C. under Stevens, Young, and Gravel, I believe that right will win and we will not end up with a compromise position. I believe Alaska will have control of its lands.
What is it that Clark Engle has lost? He owns a big game guide camp that is located in the shadow of Mount McKinley. Hunters from around the world come to this well-groomed camp to bag trophies that can only be found in Alaska.
I've never seen this fine a camp anywhere, at least in North America. This is the type of camp that Clark Engle runs is more similar to what we have in Africa. But there's quite a bit of difference in the pay scale for the help in Africa and here. So they don't quite have all the servants you got there. I think the facilities here are exemplary of what the Alaskan Professional Hunters Association has been trying to accomplish with its membership. Here comes Clark.
Alaska Review visited Engle's camp in the fall. It represents 15 years of work. And
between $200,000 and $250,000 investment over a period of many years.
For most resident hunters, life at the camp is comparatively easy. Meals are prepared by a cook, tents are warm, and the animals are butchered for you. But there still remains the hunt.
At caribou hunting, you spend a great deal of time up in a lookout scoping. Same way with moose. On sheep, you're moving more of a day. You scope a lot, but you move a lot. On bear is just about in its entirety. If you're bear, specifically bear hunting, it's strictly scoping. You sit on a good lookout and you just look until you see one of them, or more, one or more. You know, the brown bear, you'll sit on a side hill and you may see 10, 12, 14 brown bear in a day. Whereas if you're grizzly hunting, if you see one, two, three a day, well, you've had a fine day. And of course, we pick the trophies. We try to pick the finest animal for our client. Once you spot your animal, that's when the real work begins. You've got sometimes a mighty long stalk. Of course, the kill of the animal is just kind of the climax of things. There's so much more to work up to. For instance, you show them different animal tracks, different vegetation. You kind of give them a lesson on nature and the habits of the animals, this type of thing. It's not like many people suspect that it's just a free-for-all out there and the only thing you go out for is to pull a trigger, and this is not so. We try to make it an experience that they'll never forget, and the kill is not the experience. It's the stalk, the planning, the judging, all of the nature things put together. There's nothing like that bear hunting, absolutely nothing. And you don't have to kill a bear to enjoy it. Stalk a bear, many times we stalked them and took pictures of them, backed off. Sometimes that backing off gets a little hairy, you know, especially if they know you're there. But it's just something else. The moose is very, very important to the outfitters, especially the German client. They must get a moose. It's a necessity for the German client. If they don't get a moose, why, the outfitter's a bad guy.
The hunter on the Alaska Big Game Expedition pays for the services and luxury of a camp like Engle's, sometimes up to $5,000 for a week's stay.
Oh, we got a sauna out there with cookhouse with propane stove and electricity generator, shop, log shop, sleeping quarters for all of the hunters and the guides, and salt house and storage, this type of thing. It's a pretty complete camp. They take five clients at a time. Last year I had 10 employees for those five, so it's actually a 2-to-1. We've got five guides, one for each client. We have a couple packers, a camp roustabout, a couple cooks, this type of myself as pilot. So you can figure 2-to-1 on all of these, because they are paying for a service, and you try to get them the best service that you possibly can. I personally consider myself an environmentalist. A true environmentalist would not only want to protect the land, but would want to utilize the lands for whatever use they happen to be the best for. Our way of life is just fast disappearing. Not the professional hunter. I don't mean the professional hunter now. I mean just the hunter and the fisherman, the resident, that majority of the people come up here was strictly because there was good hunting, good fishing. And by God, the way the federal government's going now, there isn't going to be anything left for anybody to go out for. Because the elite, the finest physical stamina type person will be, and that and the filthy rich will be able to go out in these countries and get some utilization out of them, possibly the only ones that are really getting utilization out of them is the bureaucrats, you know, that they can fly around their helicopters and their big airplanes and look the area over to make sure there's nobody else around. It would be a difficult thing for me to explain to the president, and like I say, for a good, sound decision, he'd have to understand both, and he doesn't know. And neither does Andrus, and most of the Senate, most of the House, I would venture to say, do not understand Alaska or Alaskans. I think they're about to take a lesson, though, here in the very near future. Well, come May 10th, I'm going hunting. Same country as I used to hunt. I don't believe that a man can violate an illegal law. It's that cut and dried, that simple. I'm going hunting. That's my land. It's as much my land as it is peanut farmers or any other son of a bitch in this world.
What is so precious about Alaskan wilderness that gives the president and most of Congress reason to close it off to people like Clark Engle and prevent utilization of any of the resources of the land? The value of wilderness is hard to define, but it's a quality that many Americans revere.
If it's the last frontier, maybe we ought to think about saving some of it. Some areas set aside, possibly, so that future generations, if there are any, beyond, you know, 2000, that maybe there would be some trees for them to see.